the sense that in the keynote address, we could discuss that the risk of fraudulent claims itself is 750 to 1,000 crores for the private sector industry. And if you say private sector is 20% and LIC is 80%, and extrapolate that, it's a humongous number. This is just fraud risk. We're looking at the panel topic of business risk. And of course, as Mr. Nair pointed out rightly, that you have the underwriting risk in terms of the actual being higher than the estimated. And you would also have the other kind of business risk in terms of how do you sell? Do you actually, missell, or you give an ambitious written kind of high expectations than the actual expectations with the customer? And then, of course, face surrenders or the other risk of the refunds and things like that, and a complaint. So you have what? Free look cancellation. We have check bounces. That's an extremely very short-term risk. And then after that, you would have customer complaint pressure, and then you would have the surrenders. These are the risks we're seeing. So somewhere, again, business pressure versus the pressure on the bottom line and the reputation, more importantly. And the other side, you have the issues on the claim side. I think these are the, by and large, business risks. We're seeing there are many other risks. Of course, it's not possible to cover all the risks in a panel discussion like this. So the idea is, let's focus on the big, big items and the big tickets. So I hand over my mic to Ganesh from the left, and then we'll move the left to right. So let's Ganesh open up and speak about his favorite area, claims and underwriting, and the business risk there.
Already set. And before we start claims, probably we have to move into the business risk of surrenders, CFIs, check bounce, etc. And probably underwriting can play a big role over there. Okay, but incidentally, the way underwriting is moving these days, with the business expectations, like non-medical, non-medical, and non-medical. So we are moving in a different direction. We are talking two things. So either we are talking too much of business with simpler business, or we're talking actually risk management. So it's a big question mark which we have to answer. And also, it's equally important whether the underwriters are taking into account the surrenders, lapses, etc., while underwriting a case, or are they looking at only the medical risk of plus 25, plus 50 standard. Okay, so we had something very interesting which came up, which was required, that is the AML part of it, about 7, 8 years back. Whether the companies have incorporated AML as a part of their underwriting philosophy also, or because I have seen underwriters talking underwriting separately and AML separately. Okay, so when you do that, probably you'll get to know the reason whether a customer is able to pay. Like if you look at the mis-selling complaints at times, okay, the customer is saying that I can't pay the second year premium. So again, this can be looked at underwriting stage itself. Okay, and I'll not like to go into the part of surrenders or why after 3 years the customer moves into it. Okay, whether the selling is like that or is it the underwriting issue. Coming to the claims part, as you said, it's favorite, it's a passionate thing. We have some very interesting statistics. Okay, like if we look at, like Sundar rightly said, the proportion of private to LIC will be on the higher side. That is LIC to private, obviously. If you look at the intimations, this is from the annual report of last year, if you look at it, 74% of the claim intimations in terms of number is coming from LIC, and 26% from, oh sorry, 85% of the claim intimation is from LIC, and 15% from private sector. Though this is fairly in line with the business numbers, number of policies, issuance, etc. But when we talk about the amount of repudiation, of amount of intimation, it is 74% LIC and 26% private. Okay, which means the claim amounts that the private sector is receiving slightly on the higher side. That means the large policy tickets which you are selling on the private sector side. This is still fairly in line with the business again. But if you look at the claims repudiations, LIC is rejecting only 46% of the claims, whereas the private sector is rejecting 54%. Now, which is, there are two questions that is to be asked. One is LIC having no problems and only private sectors having problems, or is it that private sectors are able to catch the problems? So we don't have an answer for this, but at least we all know that the private sector companies, all the 23, are talking to each other. There's an underwriting association, there is a claims association, and incidentally, I'm the president of the claims association, so can authentically say that we are very well connected, and that goes exactly in line with what Sundar started off the day with, saying that we need to compete only in business part, not on the risk management part. So at the claim stage, all of us are talking to each other. Okay. And if a customer comes up with a claim and he's not informed about existing policy, the 23 private insurance companies are able to collate. And we have seen cases where a customer is having 18, 19 policies and none of them are disclosed. Okay, one part. And second is, there are cases where 18, 19 insurers have been approached. Now, this is not insurance. And this is surely not mis-selling, right? That means there is a fraudulent intent on part of some people. I'm not saying India is a fraud country. So, though the numbers may look big, that means there are people or there are cartels which are approaching various insurance companies, and LIC is also not left out. But incidentally or unfortunately, LIC doesn't participate in this, so we don't have complete statistics. We do respect to them. But what happens is these private companies are able to collate these facts together and reject cases. Which means if the universe, the sample is the same country population, that means even LIC is likely to be hit. Okay, so the figures may not be completely giving the real facts. And as I said some time back, when I was looking at the public disclosure figure of LIC, it was interesting to see 70% of their own claims rejected is more than 2 years old. That means what we are talking about frauds is equally applicable to them as well. And Sundar also pointed out some time back about the thin line difference between non-disclosure and fraud. Okay. There is, because it may not be fair on our part to say a guy forgot to say he's got blood pressure and we say, okay, he's a fraud. And by now, the insurance companies are matured enough not to reject such cases, which is very visible from the reputation ratios itself, which is not more than 4-5%, etc. But out of these 4-5%, 50% appears to be a fraudulent ones, which are industry cartels as well. And that those numbers are huge enough to set up an insurance company itself as per IRDA guidelines of 100 crores capital. So which is a serious thing if you are talking about 100 crores, 200 crores, 300 crores fraud. If I don't say that entire reputations are frauds, that could be technical reasons, that could be other reasons, non-disclosures, etc., unintentional. So even if the fraud were to be only 100 crores, forget about the bigger numbers, that means one insurance company can be set up by the fraud cartel, which is something very serious which you have to look at, right? And the cartels, when we talk about, is very evident from the fact that there are various regions which is having these defined cartels where they are public printing documents right from age proof till death certificate. I'm sure the claims department of most of the companies would have seen 3 to 4 original death certificates. And when we do an RTI, we get 2 of them reversed. Now, there are no questions being asked to these authorities, how did you issue a death certificate? Now, this cannot be a mis-selling, this cannot be a fraud at an insurer's level, this is a fraud at a bigger level. And sometimes not even the customer, it's a cartel which is doing this business. And I'm not sure how many of you are aware, just 4 days back, one of the claims investigators was murdered in West Bengal. Yeah, he was murdered. Till now, we have been seeing cases of these guys being tied up, beaten badly, brutally, being chased. And in a couple of cases, you also heard they're being abducted for a day or two and kept in a locked room. But this is the first time you're hearing that this guy was actually brutally murdered. This is a case of one general insurance company where they were doing an investigation. The mistake of the investigator or the company is that it's an early claim within 10 to 15 days, so they investigated it. So, why does this happen? Because there is no law in the country which says financial crime is a crime. This is section 420, which talks about this thing. But then if you go for a police case, they say, have you suffered a loss? That means unless you suffer a loss, you can't file a police complaint. That means if you reject a claim, you cannot hang the guy. And our regulations say that in case you reject, you still have to pay fund value. You still have to pay refund the premium. That means if I am a fraudster, it's a great business deal for me. I invest some money. If caught, I lose nothing but get my investment portfolio back. And if not caught, I get a sum assured, which is 5 times, 10 times, etc. And there is no legal action against me. There is no nothing which will hamper my life. In fact, that is one of the reasons. Just before Mr. Arkin, I was going, you're talking to him. About 6 months back, we had made a presentation to the regulator, wherein a core committee was formed for a fraud management circular, which had come about 1 year back. And we had identified CIBIL as the insurance repository the way banks have. So the purpose was that we'll have a repository at an insurance industry level, where we are not talking currently with all the 100% of the policies, new business data to be there, because the insurers also have their own difference of views and fear factor and insecurity that should I share my information completely. So what was agreed by all the 24 companies, because it was approved in the Life Council of the Executive Council, that we will share at least the last 3 years claims data, and any fraudulent employee, agents, brokers, medical agencies, etc., which is there currently, like the negative list of regions, the legacy list of agents, or your investigators, or your medical panels. We have Excel files and emails floating around the private companies. But this is not the best way, because how long are the mails going to be relied? Because there are people who do not respond to mails. And only when they get hit, they look into the mail, "Are ha, 10 saal, 10 din pehle aaya tha." So that's not authentic. So if a repository comes into place, then the benefit, even if the financial crime part is not taken care of, what happens is, suppose if I'm an investigator or a medical center or an agent or whoever, if my name goes into CIBIL as a negative list, suspicious or proved fraud, then it's not only the insurance sector that my guy gets affected. He doesn't get a credit card, loan, etc., because all the banks which are already matured on the repository part, they have got complete access to it. And they will say, "Oh, this is a negative guy, so I will not give him loans, etc." Which would mean a medical center not getting a loan. Because the commonality of PAN card or the address or the phone numbers will be thrown up by CIBIL or any other repository whoever is selected. So this will be the benefit. So we are trying to do that. And once that happens, at least we'll be one step ahead of where we are. But then that will not reduce the risk, but at least it will just bring in a factor of fear somewhere. But second part is the reduction of risk part. Okay, maybe we can take it forward.
You, yeah, that is, would sharing data at the claim stage be enough? Won't you think that we need to then do it upfront at the beginning itself?
We discussed
it. Get it stronger. Then you would have a better kind of.
Okay, the question is like.
Mitigation.
Is the statement prevention better than cure? It's a universal truth. Ideally, it's better, but we all took it up by the Life Council. There was some fear factor, some animosity saying that, no, we don't want to share our information. Already data leakage is a big issue. Okay, and forget about different companies. Within the same company, most of us have experienced that you sell a policy and after 15 minutes, like, I get a call from another channel itself. So because of this fear factor, people didn't want to do it. So we thought that at least let's start it off. And once people see that something is happening, stage 2 will happen. Or else it will be a situation where we will say, let all the signals be green, only then I'll start my car. Your car will always be in a garage.
Right. So, Dev, I wanted you to discuss on other mistakes. Top line versus the quality of sales, and in terms of spurious calling and the problem that you see.
See, I think. Ganesh has made a long, very, very detailed explanation. So let me leave that aside and go into the other issues. See, the first of the topic itself, business versus risk. It's not business versus risk, it's business risk actually. So the risks have to be understood by the business, and that's the most important part of the whole exercise. You know, we can keep on discussing risk, and we'll keep discussing risk. And others might feel that we are discussing business, let us keep discussing business and let twain never meet. If that happens, then whatever we do, we keep doing in our own silos and we don't reach any conclusion. And I think mis-selling and this initial issues of now spurious call, which has now become very famous and We see it everywhere, IRDAI is mandated, so all this, we see it in all advertisements, we hear it. You know, it's like a wave, you know, it keeps coming and still, sometimes you feel, yes, we're doing something, it'll come down again after a while. We go back to, you know, feeling as if it's the same thing, you know, nobody bothers, and it's again the same amount of spurious calls going around. Now, there come quite a few issues here, you know, I feel. One, first is, what is mis-selling? I think that's one thing which we never, as an industry or even with the ombudsman, see, earlier ombudsman didn't take up mis-selling cases. Now they have started taking it up. Have we tried to define it as, at least these are the at least four or five major parameters that should be met when I consider something mis-selling, as a mis-selling. So every ombudsman, particularly those from non-insurance background, have now created their own definition, depending on what they want to understand and what they feel will, what I can say, so earn them so-called brownie points. And that's the biggest risk which we are running today. So in spite of some of these cases not to be, which should not ought to be considered under mis-selling, we are getting a lot of cases which are going under mis-selling. I have personally seen cases where three premiums have been paid on the same policy, and after that the person has gone and cleared mis-selling and the ombudsman has awarded a full return of premium with interest. So I the basic issue is, if we have to stop this, we should have a proper infrastructure which should be supported by legal infrastructure. Our legal infrastructure just does not support these things today. You know, in cyber crime, we are doing so many things. We've got a new, you know, separate cyber crime police station. I think for financial crime, something similar, police has to come up with something similar. You know, police just do not want to understand financial crime. And that's become the biggest issue. First is, what is your loss? Even if I catch somebody trying to steal and he's not stolen, then he's not a culprit. You know, these are the kind of questions which kind of continuously puzzles me, you know, when I look at the way we are dealing with. Second is, also we need to be understanding, you know, even as a customer, if I've been cheated, if you feel I've been cheated in a mis-selling case, and I tell you, okay, sir, I'm filing a police complaint, can you come and help me? In 99.5 cases, the customer will say, no, I don't have the time. If that is the kind of understanding, then how do I control that? See, as Ganesh rightly pointed out, there has to be some kind of fear put into the person. Today we are not able to instill enough fear on the people. People are moving out with impunity. People are moving from one company to other, one broker to other. One same telecalling unit moves from one broking unit to the other broking unit with 1,000 people. And the same amount of mis-selling happens. Unless we are able to put a framework and put that fear into people, I do not think we are in any position today to stop mis-selling. Second point which I would like to take up on mis-selling is underwriting guidelines. I think we spend a lot of time, you know, whatever we do on medical, non-medical, but I personally come from a banking background, and Sundar would vouch for me in this regard. I feel, you know, financial underwriting is still something which is like the poor cousin, you know, in the underwriting department. So, when you look at somebody, you know, how do I look at it? See, I look at a person in the bank from the whether he has the ability, you know, to pay that installment. A simple thing, a housing loan, a car loan, or a consumer loan. When I put the same person, I think Girish is here, he's been in car finance for a very long time and I've known him for very long. So he can also vouch for this. But when I come here, I come up here, I declare a 2 lakh ITR, put a proposal form, I put say 10 lakhs, and say I have rental income, this, that. And business just signs a declaration, we accept that. And that goes through with a 5 lakh premium. Next year the same fellow comes back, tells you, I have showed you ITR of 2 lakhs, how can I pay 5 lakhs every year? So where is the insurance premium? I mean, how important is insurance premium to me? It is not, if obviously it is less important to me than the housing loan I am paying and the other things I am paying, housing loan installments I am paying. So therefore the financial underwriting has to be much more stringent in this case, you know, as compared to what we are doing today. I keep seeing requests for, you know, making things simpler, accepting non-standard income proof for higher level limits. But more I see of it, more I see this is one of the base areas where we are missing the bus. Because we are continuously trying to sort of placate ourselves by telling, no, no, this fellow has this surrogate income proof. But how good is the surrogate income proof? Are we trying to evaluate it? You know, I remember in case of, again, I'll quote from the vehicle industry. In case of commercial vehicles, there's always a problem. You know, you never have a commercial vehicle owner with 10 trucks or 20 trucks who will show enough income in their income tax returns. But what we go by is the number of truck he owns, what is the hypothecation level, when it was hypothecated. Because each truck has to have some basic amount of running and rolling over, based on which the surrogate income is coming. Here, what is the surrogate income we are taking? Nothing, a declaration. What is the value of the declaration? I think that's a very important point which I would like to stress upon. And I think we need to change. We need to change our mindset on this. It's a mindset issue. The third is, I think, Ganesh also touched about AML. I think AML becoming part of the underwriting philosophy is extremely important. If that does not happen, again, a lot of things will slip through, as usual. It is unfortunate that this civil project is still on hold, and we just hope that it comes through. Because without having a proper and a secure database, it will be very difficult for us as an industry to keep controlling these kind of factors. Just last two words on this. One is data leakage is definitely becoming one of our major problems. It's within the organization or whether across the organization. And I think as an industry, we need to find a solution for this. And second major issue is, you know, there is no stigma today for being a fraudster. Rather, you are adulated, you know, for being a fraudster. Earlier, when I started my career in late 1980s, you know, if you were caught doing a fraud and thrown out of a bank or something, that was a big thing, you know, that, I mean, like that person won't show his face next day. Here, it does not happen anymore. I think that's the biggest change. So therefore, the fear factor is extremely important. Thanks.
These are very valid points in terms of the deterrent control being pushed up, that thing. Sri Kumar, I think you've been CEO, right, before RIS. So I think that'll be very important to dwell on the quantum versus the risk. And there is a theory that if the numbers are large, I mean, the kind of business that you accept, then you could live with non-medical. You could live with risks because the denominator factor would sort of... And if you create systems which are... You know, you manage the risk. I mean, of course, you can't prevent risk because you're in business. So, what we're talking about is getting down the risk to a tolerable level. So, how do you then strengthen the gate? Is it that you strengthen the gate in the beginning or you do it in the claim stage? Or you do it later, and with the challenges of the changes that are going to come, in the sense that you can't repudiate after 3 years, how do you see the dimensions changing?
Thank you. Actually, I have an experience. I've been in the marketing side for a while, and then after that, I was as a chief operating officer, as a deputy chief operating officer, I've handled both portfolios and now I'm into risk. So I had a chance of looking at the entire spectrum firsthand. When I was chief operating officer, deputy chief operating officer, what I could see was, I have a background of life insurance, LIC also. What I could find is that most of the fraudulent claims are coming are from people from within the industry who had worked in the industry for some time and now have come out of the industry. And they are putting in these fraudulent claims because they have an insider knowledge of the process of claim settlement and what is to be done. This is the single most significant threat. Now, in the last 4 or 5 years, the industry is stagnant, business volumes are stagnant. So you see a lot of churn in the marketing field. And those guys who have exited the marketing teams are getting into this majorly, and cartelization is happening, and then very specific concerted attempts are made to pump in dead man insurance and death claim, and also AIDS. People are suffering from AIDS or terminal illnesses. And recently what we have noticed is that because of the business pressures, there is a concerted effort from the sales teams to liberalize underwriting per se. So the limits for non-medical have gone up, and the underwriting is almost non-existent. If you take the Indian economic parameters, then most of the Indians will be begin insurance without any underwriting whatsoever under non-medical norms. This has also become an area of focus. What we are seeing is under the non-medical limits, people are trying to pump in proposals. They are following the volumes game now. So the cartel is creating a large number of proposals, pushing them, some of them get caught, and many of them go through, they pay 2-3 premiums and then they file the claim. So we need to, as an industry, need to revisit the entire underwriting norms for non-medical. Do we need to continue to be so liberal? Because, insurance, once you have a sufficient number of proposals which have entered into the system, fraudulent proposals entered into the system, then the insurer will start to bleed. Because, and I'm really, really worried if something like this happens after 3 years, you compulsorily have to pay. Then I think many companies will go into the red. Because we have seen that the mortality experience has gone adverse for non-medical limits already. In my company, already it has gone into, it's over the mortality experience that we have budgeted for. So there is a concentrated and focused attempt on this, which you are very, very worried. And the claims, I was also part of the claims, representations which happen, we review. We find very clearly that the situation is becoming more and more rampant all over the place. What is to be done? Well, we need to revisit the non-medical limits. We need to revisit the way we look at proposals which come under non-medical. We need to have a look at it. This is going to be the single biggest threat. And then risk control units have to play a very, very major role. And where we have to do random sampling at the branch level before the underwriting takes place, so that people know that there will be a chance that the risk control unit will catch. It's a very good preventive measure. So we should have very active risk control units, and a proper reporting on fraud and investigation units, and the sharing of data is very, very important across industry right now, because the fraudsters are ahead of the game. We are only reacting. So it's very essential that at least in a limited way, whatever data that the companies are comfortable with, we should share. And at the time of underwriting, we should have this data with us, that area-wise distribution of frauds, area-wise cartelization which is happening. I observed that in all our companies, Delhi, Lucknow, Rajasthan, Ahmedabad, are these names striking a bell? Yeah, these are the places where we are all experiencing it. We should get together on this more in depth.
Bhavnagar, Puginagar,
Jamnagar, yes.
Ankapalli.
Ankapalli, I got 4 dead man insurance claims just recently.
When LIC person I met, it's the same experience. Ongol, Varangal.
Yes, and it is the same group which is operating.
Absolutely.
So I think these are concerns which I have seen as a chief operating officer and also as a head of risk now. I think that I really feel that this particular forum is very important to sensitize our companies on the effects of this. And I'm very confident that the sales pressure will continue, and they will not let us bring in any restriction measures, because the business this year also is not really very good for the companies. So the pressures are going to continue, but we need to sensitize the management. That's very important.
Yeah, because you lose a lot of money in just 2 years, 3 years, when surrenders happen and frauds happen in the claims issue. So,
if I can add two things which you spoke of. One, you said some time back on the in-house person, that is the industry person who moves out subsequently, does the frauds. There is enough evidence to show that, as you rightly said, the marketing people, the sales people who quit, they are involved in it, one. It's also the investigation units.
Yes.
There are many investigators who are actually becoming agents, officially and unofficially. Officially would mean they take a license, unofficially is license in somebody else's name. Okay, now the risk you run is, investigators are the guys who exactly know how a claims can be, how a claims moves, how it is, how the trail works, how to get the evidence, etc.
Yes.
And they have actually rejected claims in the past, and once they move into that domain, they have sufficiently removed those documents away from the hospitals. And they have guided the customers to go to the court.
Absolutely.
Okay. So this is one part. And second part is on the sharing of locations, you said. Just about a month back, all of us had met. Almost the entire private insurance industry was there in the claims committee meeting. And we had prepared a template of all the insurance companies. All the private insurance companies had shared their negative list of locations. Privacy, their negative list of medical centers, etc., or certain important agents or people who know are running some cartels in their industry, in their company. And we have made a common presentation shared across with all the companies. So yes, all of us have it. Now, only thing is, how do we take it forward with our risk control, respective risk control units and underwriting?
Well, true.
So in my company, we have put it as a negative list, and all these cases do not move through STP.
I think we all commonly benefit if we take a negative list, and I think we need to meet once or twice and then, you know, finalize this. One thing, what you're saying is the investigators getting compromised. That we have also started experiencing. But you know, what is my worry actually in the non-medical range is, we are able to catch one or two and send for investigation, but there may be at least 20-30 which are being paid, which is actually compromising the profitability of the company. This is my worry. This is where we need to re-examine our underwriting practices.
Coming back to my question, so you're saying that we need to tighten the gate rather than...
Not tighten the gate, maybe look at it a different way also, innovatively also. I mean, let us see how to assess the life of a non-medical. Can we have some protocols or can we have some any other way? We need to do a brainstorming on this, because I'm sure once you open the gate, nobody will allow you to shut it or even close it halfway, you know, and given the business pressure. Let's be candid about it.
Analytics is one of the
area
that is talked about, wherein you have lead indicators and lag indicators. So lead indicators actually throw the negative areas in terms of the data. For that, of course, it is imperative that industry shares the data at application stage itself. The rejections, the bad experiences, all that we've spoken about. So, unless we get together and share it, I don't think we'll be back at the same drawing board or table.
I think analytics and inferences, industry-wide, we need to really move.
Absolutely, yeah. So that's
because it's in common interest of all.
I think a very, very valid point. We had presentations by three analytic companies in the council, and that's how we first phase one, as he rightly said, LexisNexis was selected. Sorry, Civil was selected. That's phase one. But this is on the, again, postmortem, only the claims data after it has occurred. But we're planning to go to the next phase, wherein we we can look at the sharing at the application stage.
This was through the council and through the regulator. So what we wanted is the regulator should actually make it
mandatory.
Mandatory thing.
So unless 80% of the industry, which is LIC, comes in, you have a problem. So.
I'll just tell you one thing. See, today we people have a roundtable conference over here where we are talking about the different type of risks or whatever the way in which we people can mitigate or document or share things between us. Okay. None of us had any this kind of either conference or meeting or whatever it is. On the asset side of the balance sheet, we have put one of the huge system for investments. How did it happen? We have been working on that one. We have made 5 different amendments for all these years. Where from it has come? We people have constantly interacted with each other. Regulator was a part of the whole discussion. We have moved it everything through the council. It was not even in a formal way, we people did not even do it. We have done it. If you have that kind of a mechanism, and we all have agreed for one common standard that we will pitch it across without differentiating even between the private sector and the public sector. It's one standard that we people have kept across. Have you brought that kind of a standard for this one? We people are here today. But all people from different clusters should represent here. Second thing, move it through the council. Then make the regulator as a part of it, that it becomes easy for me to move it within the ministry, all those things. See, ministry should be a part of it. Regulator should be a part of it. PSU should be a part of it. Private sector should be a part of it. If you do not bring all the people into one forum to agree for a minimum standard, it will be difficult for us to pitch on.
No,
number one. Second thing, once if I have agreed, that should be a third person to ensure the compliance of it. If you do not ensure the compliance of it, we will be talking, it never percolates into action.
That's the missing piece.
See, the compliance is something what I will be insisting like anything. If there is no compliance for whatever we talk, then it is something, I see, what is ultimately regulation? You put it on a piece of sheet. If it is not compliant, what is the use of having a regulation over there? There's nothing.
Correct.
See, enforcement is something what we people are completely missing on the board. Look at the way we people have gone about for all the assets side of the balance sheet, enforcement and compliance, which has gone up to your board level. IRDA doesn't step into it right through till it reaches your board. Don't involve the regulator. There, see, you require regulator only to bring a regulation. But the mechanism to enforce the regulation should be kept outside the regulatory body. If you do not do that one, let me tell you, these actions will never percolate. That's all.
Good point.
Risks,
take this feedback, because we've done all that. LIC was involved in all these meetings. Life Council was the place where the meetings were held. The only issue is compliance we haven't done. So I think that mechanism is a missing piece. So. We have to get back, of course. Any other thoughts and questions? Please feel free to share. I think Girish wants to share something.
I have an observation than a comment. I heard all of you. And I believe I am the only one who is not a risk keeper. But from the pure operational and business management side, I heard my friend Deb saying fear, creating fear in the minds of people so that they don't commit. I heard him saying whether our underwriting is too liberal. I heard Ganesh also talking about claims experience. See, all this is an unavoidable part. I am reminded of Citibank founder's famous line saying that you can only manage the risk in business, can never eliminate it. Now, point here, my observation and what comes out of this discussion is, we are a company or a unit of multiple silos who don't talk to each other. And that picture we give to outside, and that's how we are perceived. I run the company. When I saw that I pay around 10 to 11% of my total gross new business, in claims, I said this needs to be conveyed to my sales team. And I have started personally writing letters from my desk to my distributors, who are my bank regional managers, that you have done this much business, but I have also paid this much money in claims. The response was fantastic. They said, oh, we never knew that there is a window there also. There is a gate open on that side also. It helped because they are seasoned managers. So they've responded very well. What I have seen in my career is we do not educate sales on whatever we are discussing. Risk or fraud control unit or claims department discuss all this either with CEO or in silos or seminars like this. I think there has to be a better interaction between sales and you guys. There has to be a much elevated communication between you and sales guys. I remember my days with SBI Life, being a passionate salesman, I had requested underwriting department that you should send 5 to 10 files every day to me before you take a decision, just to understand what kind of paper is coming in. And I used to write small comment on files if I find them little inappropriate. And I found one file wherein I have wrote that there is something fishy about this. In 9-10 months, it came in as a claim from Bihar. And Bihar continues to surprise me, actually, even today after 12 years. The point here is, because I was involved, I knew what kind of paper is coming in, what kind of selling is happening. The mis-selling wagera to hoga. I mean, even on loans and retail loans and banking, there is this menace. And are people getting into fraudulent practices? It happens everywhere. How are we structured as an industry to handle this problem is far more important rather than talking about the problem, is what I feel. Because yesterday I saw one newspaper advertisement which says, oh, do you have NPA issues? Don't go to the bank. Come to me. I will help you solve your... don't get stressed. And Niche, there was a name of the guy, and in bold he says, ex-banker. So it's everywhere. How do we really manage this? And as an industry, I think we have still not evolved enough to handle this, to have a structure which really cuts through verticals and departments and educate sales on this. Believe me, if we do that, I'm doing it in a small manner in our company, how much success we will have, only time will tell. But a larger observation is we do not convey this, whatever we are discussing, to the people who are responsible for acquisition in the company. That's all. Some of you might not like my observations, but
this is very valid.
It's completely true. And in fact, as you rightly said, risk people do not generally talk. This used to happen last couple of years, last 3 years, I can to be precise. When I'm talking to the business heads and I'm presenting, like every quarter, when I give them the claim strategy, they say, this is the business you did. And in this business, itna aapka percentage claims mein ja chuka hai. And the costing of it. So they said, oh, I did not know. So initially, when I should say, "Arey, apko MIS to bheja tha," I realized that sending an MIS doesn't really work. Just call them across and explain it to them. And then there were occasions where the moment I would publish that these are the negative regions, they said that we will shut down shop over. In the month of March, two of my business units said we will not do business here in the month of March. That means they were that really literate enough to accept the fact. And they said, okay, do one thing. You can, I don't want you to change underwriting norms at this stage. But remove it from your fast track processing and let it go through. Any problem, let me know. And what did it? We started with the MHR process, where the moral hazard report, where they said, just increase it by one level up wherever you find it suspicious. And it works. So fully agree with what you say. So there's nothing to feel bad about it. I think that's your experience.
Evidence is very, very important. The moment that it's a certain area, people know that you're aware that the fraudulent claims of this type are occurring, automatically I see a drop. Of course, it diverts to another area or into another plan. But still, it's only a game. It's a cat and mouse game which goes on. Awareness among, even among the marketing guys, awareness is good. It does bring it down. But you know, most of the frauds are happening through concerted action. Those people are not deterred. They only change their game and life, the style. That's what we are observing, which is very disturbing.
Yeah.
I just want to add, we talk about
that will not reduce the risk, but at least it will just bring in a factor of fear somewhere. But second part is the reduction of risk part. Okay, maybe we can take it forward.
Would sharing data at the claim stage be enough? Wouldn't you think that we need to then do it upfront at the beginning itself?
We discussed this.
Get it stronger. Then you would have a better kind of
Okay, the question is like,
mitigation.
Is the statement prevention better than cure? It's a universal truth. Ideally, it's better, but we all took it up by the Life Council. There was some fear factors of animosity saying that, no, we don't want to share our information. Already data leakage is a big issue. Okay, and within, forget about different companies, within the same company, most of us have experienced that you sell a policy and after 15 minutes, the guy gets a call from another channel itself. So because of this fear factor, people didn't want to do it. So we thought that at least let's start it off. And once people see that something is happening, stage 2 will happen. Or else it will be a situation where we will say, let all the signals be green only, then I'll start my car. Your car will always be in the garage.
Right. So therefore, I wanted you to discuss on other selling side. Top line versus the quality of sales, and in terms of spurious calling and the problem that you see.
See, I think Ganesh has made a long, very, very detailed explanation. So let me leave that aside and go into the other issues. See, the first of the topic itself, business versus risk. It's not business versus risk, it's business risk actually. So the risks have to be understood by the business, and that's the most important part of the whole exercise. You know, we can keep on discussing risk, and we'll keep discussing risk. And others might feel that we're discussing business, let us keep discussing business and let twain never meet. If that happens, then whatever we do, we keep doing in our own silos and we don't reach any conclusion. And I think mis-selling and this initial issues of now spurious call, which has now become very famous and we see it now everywhere, IRD is mandated, so all the, we see it in all advertisements, we hear it. You know, it's like a wave, you know, it keeps coming and still, sometimes you feel, yes, we're doing something, it'll come down again after a while. We go back to, you know, feeling as if it's the same thing, you know. Nobody bothers and it's again so the same amount of spurious calls going around. Now, there come quite a few issues here, you know, I feel. One, first is, what is mis-selling? I think that's one thing which we never, as an industry or even with the ombudsman, see earlier ombudsman didn't take up mis-selling cases. Now they have started taking it up. Have we tried to define it as, at least these are the at least 4 or 5 major parameters that should be met when I consider something mis-selling, as a mis-selling. So every ombudsman, particularly those from non-insurance background, have now created their own definition, depending on what they want to understand and what they feel will, what I can say, so earn them so-called brownie points. And that's the biggest risk which we are running today. So in spite of some of these cases not to be, which should not ought to be considered under mis-selling, we are getting a lot of cases which are going under mis-selling. I have personally seen cases where 3 premiums have been paid on the same policy, and after that the person has gone and cleared mis-selling and the ombudsman has awarded a full return of premium with interest. So, I the basic issue is, if we have to stop this, we should have a proper infrastructure which should be supported by legal infrastructure. Our legal infrastructure just does not support these things today. You know, in cybercrime, we're doing so many things. We've got a new, you know, separate cybercrime police station. I think for financial crime, something similar, police has to come up with something similar. You know, police just do not want to understand financial crime. And that's become the biggest issue. First is, what is your loss? Even if I catch somebody trying to steal and he's not stolen, then he's not a culprit. You know, these are the kind of questions which kind of continuously puzzles me, you know, when I look at the way we are dealing with. Second is, also we need to be understanding, you know, even as a customer, if I've been cheated, if you feel I've been cheated in a mis-selling case, and I tell you, okay sir, I'm filing a police complaint, can you come and help me? In 99.5 cases, the customer will say, no, I don't have the time. If that is the kind of understanding, then how do I control that? See, as Ganesh rightly pointed out, there has to be some kind of fear put into the person. Today we are not able to instill enough fear on the people. People are moving out with impunity. People are moving from one company to other, one broker to other. One same telecalling unit moves from one broking unit to the other broking unit with 1,000 people. And the same amount of mis-selling happens. Unless we are able to put a framework and put that fear into people, I do not think we are in any position today to stop mis-selling. Second point which I would like to take up on mis-selling is underwriting guidelines. I think we spend a lot of time, you know, whatever we do on medical, non-medical. But I personally come from a banking background and Sundar would vouch for me in this regard. I feel, you know, financial underwriting is still something which is like the poor cousin, you know, in the underwriting department. So, when you look at somebody, you know, how do I look at it? See, I look at a person in the bank from the whether he has the ability, you know, to pay that installment. A simple thing, a housing loan, a car loan, or a consumer loan. When I put the same person, I think Girish is here, he's been in car finance for a very long time and I've known him for very long. So he can also vouch for this. But when I come here, I come up here, I declare a 2 lakh ITR, put a proposal form, I put say 10 lakhs and say I have rental income, this, that. And business just signs a declaration, we accept that. And that goes through with a 5 lakh premium. Next year the same fellow comes back, tells you, I have showed you ITR of 2 lakhs, how can I pay 5 lakhs every year? So where is the insurance premium? I mean, how important is insurance premium to me? It is not, if obviously it is less important to me than the housing loan I am paying and the other things I am paying, housing loan installments I am paying. So therefore the financial underwriting has to be much more stringent in this case, you know, as compared to what we are doing today. I keep seeing requests for, you know, making things simpler, accepting non-standard income proof for higher level limits. But more I see of it, more I see this is one of the base areas where we are missing the bus. Because we are continuously trying to sort of placate ourselves by telling, no, this fellow has surrogate income proof. But how good is the surrogate income proof? Are we trying to evaluate it? You know, I remember in case of, again, I'll quote from the vehicle industry. In case of commercial vehicles, there's always a problem. You know, you never have a commercial vehicle owner with 10 trucks or 20 trucks who will show enough income in their income tax returns. But what we go by is the number of truck he owns, what is the hypothecation level, when it was hypothecated. Because each truck has to have some basic amount of running and rolling over, based on which the surrogate income is cut. Here, what is the surrogate income we are taking? Nothing, a declaration. What's the value of the declaration? I think that's a very important point which I would like to stress upon. And I think we need to change. We need to change our mindset on this. It's a mindset issue. The third is, I think, Ganesh also talked to us.